thank you, Professor Novotny. That last point you made about being in a kind of debate across history in this space with von Mises heightens the stakes and the excitement, for me at least, of this gathering. And I want to thank the Institute and Angie, we're going to have a conversation afterwards, for having me. This is a fateful time for democracy. And 2024, as Professor Novotny pointed out, will be a decisive moment, both in the United States and in Austria. And there are certain similarities in the challenges that we face. Just days ago, Donald Trump won a convincing victory in the Republican primary caucus in Iowa, making it very likely that in November there will be a rematch of Donald Trump and Joe Biden. It's a rematch that most Americans don't want. 70% say they would rather there be some alternative to these two figures. But it's more likely than not that we will have that rematch. And it's impossible now to predict what the outcome will be. One of the reasons that it's so difficult to predict the outcome, and why, despite all of the criminal indictments against him, and despite his promoting the lie that he actually won the last election and that it was stolen from him, and despite the fact that he encouraged the mob to attack the Capitol after he was defeated to try to prevent the certification of votes, despite all of this, his people have stuck with him. In fact, with every new indictment and criminal charge, it seems that among his supporters, their fervor and support for him, their enthusiasm, strengthens. It's not called into question. What does this mean for the Democratic Party in the United States, for Social Democrats in Europe? It means that we had better figure out why. Why is it that support runs so deep, and we see rising support for right-wing, hyper-nationalist political parties? We had better diagnose the reason. And what makes it not an easy thing for social democratic parties or progressive parties to analyze is that one of the reasons for the appeal of figures like Trump and of far-right populist parties is the deep sense of grievance among a large portion of the electorate, and especially among working people, and especially among those without university degrees. Education has become one of the best predictors of political behavior. Trump won overwhelmingly among working class voters without a university degree, especially men without a university degree. And in the social democratic parties of Europe, it used to be that these were the parties of working people. These were the parties who represented the people against the powerful, against the privileged. That was true of the Democratic Party back in the day of Franklin Roosevelt and the New Deal. That was true of the Social Democratic and Socialist parties in Europe. It was true of the Labour Party in Britain. But in recent decades, that's changed. It's changed in a way that has that also tracks education. By the 2010s, and by 2016 in particular, when Britain voted for Brexit and the US voted for Trump, the Democratic Party in the US, like the Labour Party in Britain, had become more attuned to the values and interests and outlook and cultural dispositions of the professional classes, of the well-credentialed classes, than the working class voters who once constituted their base of support. Now, how did this happen? I think we need to reconstruct how it happened, and it goes back to the 1980s. It's really something that's been unfolding over the last four decades. It began with the explicit case against government made by figures like Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher. They argued that government is the problem and unfettered markets are the solution. But even after, they were succeeded by center-left parties and politicians. What happened was, those center-left parties and politicians did not challenge the fundamental assumptions of the market triumphalist faith of the Reagan-Thatcher years. They moderated but consolidated the market faith. They did not challenge the idea that markets and market mechanisms are the primary instruments for defining and achieving the public good. They accepted that premise, but then tried to show that this could be, that the harsh consequences of that philosophy could be softened to some extent around the edges. And what they did was they embraced a version of the market faith under the banner of globalization, a certain version of globalization, a market-driven, and more precisely, a finance-driven version of globalization. Now, they assured us at the time that the neoliberal version of globalization they enacted would help everybody. Yes, there would be winners and there would be losers, they argued, but the gains to the winners can be used to compensate the losers. Well, there were gains to the winners. In fact, most of the increase in national income during the age of globalization flowed to the top 20%. The bottom half of the population faced stagnant wages in real terms for 4 to 5 decades. In the United States, at least, that was the figure. Now, this produced rising inequalities of income and wealth. But what the mainstream parties, including the center-left political parties, argued during this period was the solution to inequality is to equip yourself to compete in the global economy by getting a university degree. That essentially was the argument. And the argument was embodied in slogans that became so familiar we scarcely thought to question them. If you want to compete and win in the global economy, go to university. What you earn will depend on what you learn. This is Bill Clinton, his mantra. You can make it if you try. That was Barack Obama. He used that line 140 times in speeches. You can make it if you try. Now, this idea that the answer to inequality was individual upward mobility through higher education. This idea was the central response of center-left politicians and political parties during this period. I'm thinking of Bill Clinton initially in the United States, Tony Blair in Britain, Gerhard Schroeder in Germany. This was the response, not to address the structural inequalities, but instead to offer bracing advice to those struggling with stagnant wages and job loss due to the outsourcing of jobs to low-wage countries with few labor and environmental standards. So the neoliberal project of globalization was accompanied by a kind of ideological rationale, which brings us to the tyranny of merit, because meritocracy became the rationale for the growing divide between winners and losers. As a political project, meritocracy was summed up in these familiar slogans, in the idea that everyone should be able to rise as far as their efforts and talents will take them. Politicians, including center-left politicians, intoned this mantra again and again. I call it the rhetoric of rising. The rhetoric of rising. It has a certain egalitarian ring, the rhetoric of rising does, because it emphasizes, rightly, the importance of removing barriers to achievement. Whatever your family background, or class, or race, or ethnicity, or gender, or sexual orientation, you too should be able to rise as far as your effort and talents would take you. Who could disagree? But despite its seemingly egalitarian bent, this rhetoric of rising entrenched rather than challenged inequalities of income and wealth. It didn't propose to alleviate these inequalities by reconsidering the economic policies that produced them. Instead, it offered this workaround of individual upward mobility through higher education. What the elites missed, the elites who delivered this message, if you want to succeed, if you want to thrive, if you want to escape wage stagnation, go get a university degree. What they missed was the insult implicit in this advice. The insult was this. If you're struggling in the new economy, and if you don't have a university diploma, your failure must be your fault. That's the implication. Because at the very same time of the emphasis on individual upward mobility, you can make it if you try. This was tightening the hold of meritocratic ideas of success. So even as the divide between winners and losers deepened, there was more to this than simply growing inequality of income and wealth. What accompanied that inequality, that economic inequality, were changing attitudes towards success. Those who landed on top came to believe that their success was their own doing, the measure of their merit, and that they therefore deserved the bounty that the market bestowed upon them. And by implication, that those who struggled, those left behind, must deserve their fate too. This way of thinking about success arises from a seemingly attractive ideal, the ideal of meritocracy. The principle that says, insofar as chances are equal, the winners deserve their winnings. Now, progressives and center-left politicians would be quick to acknowledge that chances are not truly equal. Children born into low-income families tend to stay poor as adults. But that suggests the project is a relatively simple one. Simply increase equality of opportunity. Simply make good on the meritocratic promise to bring everyone up to the same starting point in the race. If only we could do that, then the results would be fair. Then the winners would deserve their winnings. But that was too narrow a project. It missed, for example, the fact that even if we could achieve truly fair equality of opportunity, it would still be morally questionable to claim that the winners deserved their winnings. You can see this by imagining a race that everyone begins at the same starting point, not only in formal terms, but where everyone also has had the same access to good training, good coaching, good nutrition, the best running shoes. Then that's fair equality of opportunity. It's still predictable who's likely to win the race. The more gifted runners, for example. And so what this way of thinking about success obscures is the role of accident, luck, and contingency in life, even in a society where we manage to bring everyone up to the same point of the race. It leads the successful, this way of thinking, this image of society as a competitive race, leads the successful to forget the luck and good fortune that help us on our way. It leads the successful to forget our indebtedness to those who make our achievements possible. And it also leads to a kind of hubris among the winners. It leads the successful to inhale too deeply of their own success and invites them almost to look down on those less fortunate than themselves, especially when the source of access to achievement, to rising, is a university degree. And in fact, elites during this period came to so valorize a university degree, both as an avenue for achievement and as the basis for social esteem, that they had difficulty understanding the hubris a meritocracy can generate, and they had difficulty understanding the harsh judgment it imposes on those who haven't been to university. In fact, the idea of meritocracy, the term was coined relatively recently, in the late 1950s, by Michael Young. He was a British sociologist affiliated with the Labour Party. This was after the war. The class system was beginning to break down. Working class kids were able, some of them, to attend good schools and compete for jobs. All of that was a good thing. But what Michael Young glimpsed was that the more fully realized the meritocratic ideal became, the harsher would be the judgment on those who didn't prevail. We've come to see meritocracy as the name of an ideal, an aspiration, even the definition of a just society. But for Michael Young, who coined the term, that's not how he thought about it. He saw it as a kind of dystopia that would create a competitive society of winners and losers, with the winners looking down, the losers feeling humiliated, and he predicted that there would be a populist revolt that would overturn the meritocratic elite. In the year, he predicted, 2034. He was right, except that populist revolt came 18 years ahead of schedule in 2016. So this is what brought us to this moment. Now, there's a lot of ugliness in the rhetoric of figures like Donald Trump and hyper-nationalist, right-wing populists throughout Europe. And that ugliness and the peril it poses to pluralism, to toleration, and to democracy, that ugliness strikes us so profoundly that it can also distract us from asking, why do the grievances to which these figures run so deep that nothing we offer working people or those who are struggling with wage stagnation and inequality seems to register? So part of my suggestion, my argument really is, that we have to try, difficult though it is, to disentangle the legitimate grievances to which figures like Trump appeal from the ugly sentiments with which they are entangled. That's not an easy thing to do, especially in the heat of a political campaign. I'm afraid it's not going to be enough to say, as I think President Biden has been saying and plans to make the basis of his campaign, democracy is on the ballot, and it's a choice between democracy and authoritarianism. True, though that may be, the Democratic Party, and social democratic parties generally, have to go further and offer a compelling vision of what democracy really means. It has to mean something more than just leaving office when you lose. It has to mean that. And as we've seen, even that's no longer assured. But that's a minimal definition of democracy. A fuller vision of democracy has to address people's sense, their legitimate sense, that their voices don't matter. It has to address the widespread sense of disempowerment. It has to address the sources of mistrust of elites, of political institutions, of experts, especially of economists. And I think social democrats and progressives need to recognize that a lot of that mistrust is well-earned. And it's been well-earned, really, looking back over the way that meritocratic elites who have promoted the neoliberal version of globalization have governed for the past four decades. Now, it's worth thinking back to the heady confidence of that time. The age of globalization, it was a triumphalist time. The Berlin Wall had fallen. Then came the breakup of the Soviet Union. This was heralded as a vindication of liberal capitalism, seemingly the only system left standing. Political leaders celebrated the flow, the unfettered flow of goods and people and capital across national borders, not only for its promise of prosperity, but also as an open, tolerant, cosmopolitan alternative to the parochial, place-bound political economy of the past. People spoke of a world without walls, a world without walls, drawing on the metaphor of the Berlin Wall falling. But this became a kind of high-minded euphemism for an economy in which national allegiances mattered less and the unfettered flow of goods and capital mattered more. To those who objected that these new fluid arrangements enabled companies to send jobs overseas to low-wage countries, or who objected that moving capital into and out of countries at the click of a mouse could prompt destabilizing financial crises, to those who raised these worries, the proponents replied, well, it was a striking, a telling reply. At the heart of the reply was this: globalization is inevitable. It's a fact of nature beyond politics. We heard this first from Margaret Thatcher, who often said, referring to the rigors of a free market, laissez-faire economy, she often said, there is no alternative. But she wasn't the only one. Center-left political leaders of the 1990s reiterated this claim of inevitability. Here's how Bill Clinton put it. He said, globalization is not something we can hold off or turn off. It is the economic equivalent of a force of nature like wind or water. That was Bill Clinton. Or Tony Blair in Britain. He said, globalization is as unalterable as the seasons. Quote, I hear people say we have to stop and debate globalization. Well, he said, you might as well debate whether autumn should follow summer. Now, although this was depicted as a force of nature beyond human agency or control, the version of globalization, the neoliberal version of globalization that these figures, and it's important that we bear in mind, these were center-left political parties who were enacting this agenda, actually demanded that government enact an extensive list of quite contestable economic policies. And we're familiar with what those policies were and what the results were. What they didn't foresee is that from this confidently asserted version of neoliberal globalization would come such profound not only inequality but also economic and social dislocation that it would pave the way for the populist backlash that came to a kind of full expression in 2016. So, what do we do about it? Well, we begin, I think, we need to begin with a frank and self-critical diagnosis about the role that elites, including center-left and social democratic parties, played in bringing about the conditions for this grievance, this roiling anger. And then we need new governing visions, animating purposes, to address the legitimate aspects of those grievances. And this requires changing the terms of public discourse. We should focus less, for example, on arming people for meritocratic competition and focus more on the dignity of work, on asking what the conditions would be for making life better for those who contribute to the economy and to the common good through the work they do and the families they raise and the communities they serve, even though they may not have a university degree. Those of us who spend our time in the company of the credentialed can easily forget a simple fact. Most of our fellow citizens don't have university degrees. In most European democracies, the figure of those who do is around 30%, around 35% in the United States. 30 to 35% have university degrees. Most do not. So it's folly to create an economy that sets as a necessary condition of dignified work and a decent life a university degree that most people don't have. Now, what would be the elements of a political project that took seriously the dignity of work? It would have to begin by contending directly with inequality and the structural sources of inequality, rather than view individual mobility as an adequate answer to inequality. The OECD did a study about the prospects of mobility, intergenerational mobility, in OECD countries and other rich countries. And they asked, how many generations at current levels of intergenerational mobility would it take for someone born into a poor family to rise, not to the top, but to the median? In Denmark, it takes 2 generations. In the United States, and in Britain, and in Austria, it takes 5. From this, I conclude that the American dream is alive and well and living in Copenhagen. So mobility is not an adequate answer to inequality. But the problem is not only inequalities of income and wealth. It's that these inequalities have been translated into inequalities of social recognition and esteem, which is why I speak of the dignity of labor, not only addressing economic inequality as such. Those left behind by the neoliberal globalization project not only struggled while others prospered, that's the straightforward economic inequality, they also came to sense that the work they do was no longer a source of social recognition and esteem. In society's eyes, and perhaps also in their own, their work no longer signified a valued and respected contribution to the common good. So any serious response to working class frustrations has to combat the elite hubris and condescension and credentialist prejudice that have become rife in the public culture. This is why it's important to put the dignity of work at the center of the political agenda. Now, this isn't as easy as it seems. No one argues against the dignity of work, but people have very different notions of what it means to realize it and to honor it. The reason this is difficult is that thinking through the meaning of work forces us to confront contested moral and political questions that we otherwise evade. And the central among those questions is, what counts as a valuable contribution to the economy and to the common good? Now, we easily slide into the assumption that the money people make is the measure of their contribution to the common good. But this is a mistake, as even, I think, most ardent laissez-faire libertarian economists would recognize. Because if it were true, then we would have to say that the value, the true value of the contribution of a hedge fund manager is 1,000 or 2,000 times greater than the value of the contribution of a teacher, or for that matter, a physician. People would be hard-pressed to make that case as a moral argument about what, about the relation, the proportion of the value of the contribution of these different roles. But what that means is, if we can't rely on the market to tell us the value of a contribution to the common good, what that means is it falls to us as democratic citizens to debate that, to work it out in public life. But to do that requires that we engage in public discourse in messy, contested debates about competing notions of the value of a contribution. They're messy and contested because to know what counts as a valuable contribution to the common good requires that we ask one another and ourselves, what are our common purposes and ends as a political community? Now, going back to Aristotle, he thought this was the first question of politics. What is the end? What are the purposes of political community? There is a tendency in liberal public discourse to try to avoid questions about the meaning of the good or of virtue of that kind, because liberals often argue we live in pluralist societies, people have different and competing notions of the good, of virtue. So wouldn't it be better, wouldn't it be make for a more tolerant society if we could set aside contested notions of the good life in politics and try to resolve our central political questions without reference to those contested ideas? But if we made a mistake these past decades to outsource our moral judgment about what's valuable to markets, if that was a mistake, then it means we can't avoid bringing into public debate contested notions of what's a valuable contribution, and therefore contested notions of the common good. The general point is this: economic concerns are not only about the money someone makes. They are also about one's role in the economy and one's standing in society. Those left behind by four decades of globalization and rising inequality were suffering from more than stagnant wages. They were experiencing what they feared, what they fear, is a growing obsolescence The society in which they live no longer seems to need the skills or contributions, or for that matter, the voice that they have to offer. Which leads me to suggest that progressive parties need to move beyond a concern only with distributive justice, important though that is, how to distribute access to the good things in life. But progressive parties need also to have something to say about contributive justice. What are the conditions under which everyone can feel, and rightly feel, that they have the opportunity to contribute to the common good and to be recognized and honored for doing so? Policy proposals that simply offer to compensate for inequality by increasing the purchasing power of working and middle-class families, or by shoring up the safety net, will not be enough. They won't be enough to address the anger and resentment that now runs deep. And this is because the anger is about the loss of recognition and esteem. Diminished purchasing power matters. But the injury that most animates the resentment of working people is to their status as producers, not only to their ability as consumers to afford the goods they need. Only a political agenda that acknowledges this injury and seeks to renew the dignity of work can speak effectively to the discontent that roils our politics. Martin Luther King understood this, and we just celebrated Martin Luther King Day in the United States. Shortly before he was assassinated, he traveled to Memphis, Tennessee, to speak to a group of striking sanitation workers, garbage collectors. And this is what he said to them. He said, "One day our society will come to respect sanitation workers, if it is to survive. Because the person who picks up our garbage is, in the final analysis, as significant as the physician. Because if he doesn't do his job, diseases are rampant." And then he added, "All labor has dignity." A political economy concerned only with the size and the distribution of GDP misses something. It misses the importance of the dignity of work, and it makes for an impoverished civic life. One of my political heroes spoke to this powerfully, Robert F. Kennedy, running for president in 1968. Shortly before he was assassinated, put it this way. He said, "Fellowship, community, shared patriotism, these essential values of our civilization do not come from just buying and consuming goods together. They come instead from dignified employment at decent pay, the kind of employment that lets a person say to his community, to his family, to his country, and most important, to himself, I helped to build this country. I am a participant in its great public ventures." Few politicians speak that way today. In the years since Robert Kennedy, progressives largely abandoned the politics of community and patriotism and the dignity of work. Instead, they offered the rhetoric of rising. The rhetoric of rising was an idealism suited to a global, meritocratic, market-driven age. It flattered the winners and insulted those left behind. By 2016, its time was up. The arrival of Brexit and Trump, the rise of hyper-nationalist anti-immigrant parties in Europe announced the failure of the project. The question now is what an alternative political project should look like. What set the market faith fundamentally at odds with the ideal of self-government was its evasion of politics, its evasion of the political. And by this, I mean the persistent attempt by proponents of neoliberal globalization to depict the economic arrangements they brought into being as facts of nature beyond human control. According to their logic, free trade agreements, the free flow of capital across national borders, the financialization of economic life, the offshoring of jobs, deregulation, recurring financial crises, the declining labor share of GDP, and the advent of technologies favoring highly skilled workers, all of these were necessary features of a global economy, not contestable developments open to political argument. This way of thinking about the economy left little room for politics, little room for public debate about how to distribute goods or how to allocate investment or how to determine the social value of this or that job. This way of thinking hollowed out public discourse and fueled a growing sense of disempowerment. Why disempowerment? Because if the basic terms of economic life are unalterable facts of nature, then there's very little left for self-government or for citizens. Politics is reduced to the task of bowing to necessity, to the necessity of a morally indefensible Wall Street bailout, to take us back to 2008, for example. If politics is mainly about adapting to the fixed imperatives of economic life, it really is an activity better suited to experts and technocrats than to democratic citizens. This shrunken conception of politics defined the age of globalization. It coincided with an inflated role for doctrinaire economists who claimed to offer a science of this necessity. But it was a spurious science, and the policymakers who imbibed it mismanaged the economy, exacerbated inequality, and created the conditions for the angry backlash that we now face. When the neoliberal faith was at high tide, Tony Blair mocked those who wanted to debate globalization. You might as well debate whether autumn should follow summer. It was smug at the time, but now seems quaint. Consider his metaphor. Climate change has reconfigured the seasons. Summer heat is arriving earlier and lasting longer. Some scientists predict that absent changes in the way we live, by the end of the century, summer could last for half the year. So what once seemed an unalterable fact of nature has become a central question for self-government, which suggests that the boundary between the necessary and the possible shifts. It shifts beneath our feet. And so today, the civic aspiration to shape the forces that govern our lives requires that we debate and decide not only the economic arrangements by which we live, but also even whether autumn should follow summer. Thank you very much.